All right. I just want to, my name is Zach O'Farrell. I'm the Director of Education Programs at the Afro-Latin Jazz Alliance. I just want to take a second before we get started and welcome everyone to this class. This is, we've done a bunch of these master classes by now during this COVID crisis, and they've been really enjoyable, and I'm particularly excited about the class today. We have my friend Everton Isidoro, who's an incredible percussionist from Brazil. He's also a really an inspiring teaching artist, and he's been teaching with the Afro-Latin Jazz Alliance, sharing his knowledge with young people throughout the city for many years now. And he's an incredible musician with an incredible wealth of experience and wisdom. And I am thrilled to introduce Everton Isidoro and for him to share his knowledge with us as part of our masterclass series. So thank you, Everton, and take it away, man.
Thank you so much, guys, for being with me here today. And that for me is such an honor to show the Ijexá, because in my opinion, it's one of the most important Brazilian rhythms, but it's not well known like the samba, especially because it's not easy to understand and to figure out how the samba, because samba has this like rhythm part that's so characteristic. And because Ijexá is so blended with the other stuff, now it's kind of complicated to understand sometimes when it's played inside of the Brazilian popular music. But I will try to help you guys in this understanding, and I show you where you guys can see the Ijexá happening. So let's start learning the basic Ijexá rhythm pattern. So the main thing It is the agogô. So, actually, to start, I need to say where the Ijexá came from, because Ijexá is one of the rhythms from the African diaspora that went to Brazil. And Ijexá is a rhythm from Nigeria, to be more specific, from the one is close of the one region called Ilexá, and there is a river that is called Oxum. And inside the African religion called Candomblé, Oxum is the orisha that we play the Ijexá to celebrate. So that's Ijexá is so important because it's not just a rhythm, but it's inside of the African religion called Candomblé. And I will say to you guys how I started like to get into the Brazilian music. So the first thing is the most important thing is the agogô bell. In the religion we say gan. It's like two cowbells, different tones. Sometimes you can see only one. And the rhythm pattern goes like that. So if you didn't play Ijexá yet, that's the way that I teach you guys how to play. And you guys are still gonna learn how to speak something Portuguese. I say, olá, tudo bem, tudo legal. So, hello, how's it going? Everything is good. So if you guys wanna try, olá, tudo bem, tudo legal. 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 So that's the agogô rhythm pattern. And now, in Candomblé, we have three instruments like this. Today, I have only one in my house, but we have three in three different sizes. We call rum, rumpi, and lé. So lé is the smaller one, and it's going to be the one that I'm going to show you guys how to play right now. I'm showing this one. I think maybe it'll be easy to understand. It's only slap, open slap. One thing that's really important, and we muffle the slap when you play. And you should start with the slap and repeat the slap to like seek inside of the rhythm pattern. So it's always pa, pa, pum, pa, pa, pum, pa. That's the lé rhythm pattern. Don't forget, this close is so important. Because kind of, can you see, when you play the slap to open the sounds, like it's too much. So, always the muffle with the slap. Slap, open, slap. The lé rhythm pattern. Now you're gonna learn the rumpi. So goes like that. A one, two, three, My album over here is gonna be helpful. So let me see. You got it. Mm-hmm. gonna start. Bah. So this note is not a ghost note. It's not like actually a real note, the first one, because the downbeat is more important. That comes with the right hand. So. Bah. The first note of the papa, the two slaps, is kind of like low, you know? Some people, sometimes in Salvador, I heard people playing just slap. Did you get that part? So now we're going to whom? Inside of the candomblé, this African religion, the whom is one of the main instruments because they're responsible for the connection between the dance of the orisha and the music. Sometimes you can see the guy that is playing the room, you can think he's like improvising, but actually he's just like following the steps in the dance that's going on during the celebration. So that's the thing that I did at the beginning of the class. I was playing the room, I was actually playing those kind of like improvisation rhythm. So I'm gonna put the loop again and you're gonna do some of the phrases of the room. Some of the phrases that the room plays. Now, can I share some of the videos that I choose with you guys? Is it possible? Because I picked some videos that is videos that are gonna start showing how the Ijexá got out of the terreiros of the religion, start being searched in the Brazilian, the popular Brazilian music. The first group to do that was a group called Filhos de Gandhi, and in Brazil, the groups that has the Ijexá as a main rhythm to create your music, we call Afoxé. So some people say, call this rhythm Ijexá the Afoxé, but like two things completely different. Afoxé is the group, the carnival groups, that use the Ijexá as rhythm pattern to create the music. So I pick one video that I'm going to show you guys, the most traditional Afoxé group.
Hey Everton, would you mind turning up your microphone a little bit?
Turn up?
Yeah.
Can you hear me better right now?
Yeah, thank you, man.
I think it's the position. So now I'm gonna show you guys one of the most traditional groups. Let me just find out. So, great. Another thing that happens a lot in Salvador is not argument, but people say, oh, the Ijexá, you start from the bottom to the top. You stop the top to the bottom. Who explains this? I think it was my computer. So, and there is this thing people, oh, you're going to start from the top, you start from the bottom. Actually, it's just a matter of space, how you prefer. Some people start from the one on the top. Some people start from the bottom. The one that I hear the most, it is starting from the top one. And in my opinion, it's the one that sounds better, you know? So. So that's my favorite way to play the agogô bell inside of the Ijexá. And later, with the Filhos de Gandhi, Ijexá started like become so famous and it stopped just to be like a music for the carnival, and people start like to use it in the popular music. One of the first people to do that was Clara Nunes, in a song actually called Ijexá. There's another song that I'm going to show you guys like a little bit of. So this way, you can hear more clear because she's saying the name of the song, it is Ijexá. But now, this song is around the, like the 70s. You guys are going to see around the 80s, how you're going to see the Ijexá music, but without the clave, show you, oh, that's Ijexá. Now I have another example of the song. There's one song called like Olhos Coloridos, like Colorful Eyes, and you guys are gonna hear the Ijexá. Did you guys notice now the guitar is playing the Ijexá rhythm part? That's one of the most famous Brazilian songs, Olhos Coloridos, like Colorful Eyes. The rhythm part right now is the guitar. It became more pop, and now they're using bass drums, snare drums, like a whole kit, and bass, and guitar, and voice. And usually, inside the ceremonies, you just sing in Yoruba. And because, of course, we went to the popular Brazilian music, we sing in Portuguese. And I have another song to show you guys. Then you're gonna see the same thing. This famous singer called Let me see. Djavan. This song is from 1982. Can you see the clave is not the same, but like you can see like pieces of the Ijexá clave inside the music. That's another example of the Brazilian song with the Ijexá. Now, I'm gonna give you guys an example the way now people are playing, because in the ceremonies, you need one musician playing each instrument. And right now, because we use the stage, we like reducing the number of musicians. So, that's what we do right now. It's gonna be like a frequent thing, gonna see often in Brazil people playing this way. Sometimes you cannot have like four musicians or five musicians just playing percussion and reduce the number, and that's what I do. Like one guy play agogô and the lead the same time and the rhythm pattern the same. Show you guys that we do a lot as well, and instead, because like I said, sometimes we don't play the clave to don't show like how we play Ijexá, we play Ijexá. So what you do, you play the lé e the rum, so the one that do the improvisation is the same one that do the first rhythm part. It goes like that when you play together. Another way to play Ijexá. So, should I keep going with the Ijexá? You guys want to have some questions? So, I finished my the way until Ijexá become so like inside of the Brazilian music. So, during the 70s and early 80s, this group that I showed you guys in the beginning
called Filhos de Gandhi was about to close the doors because the carnival in Brazil became so, like, how can I say, another music style became more famous, the Ijexá, like samba reggae, the samba. And so this group called Filho de Gama was about to, like, close the doors, and this musician called Gilberto Gil, and he created a song, like a kind of tribute to Filhos de Gandhi. And people say that now Filhos de Gandhi exist because Gilberto Gil created the song and brought the Filhos de Gandhi to the scene again. So that's the song that I'm going to show you guys right now. The name of the song is Filhos de Gandhi. It's composed by Gilberto Gil and Jorge Benjó. Some taste of the something around the 90s of the Ijexá, and now I'm gonna show you guys something more modern, and not even going to hear any percussion, any drums playing, but it is songs like inspired by the Ijexá rhythm part. Another song inspired by Ijexá. The Ijexá is the main rhythm, and I have one more to show you guys. Let me share this one. I think that's gonna be the last one. there's another song inspired by the Ijexá rhythm. So there's another song inspired by the Ijexá rhythm. Now I wanna show you guys another fusion that happened with the Ijexá that, in my opinion, that I heard lately was the most incredible one. Like 2 or 3 years ago, the Afro Latin Jazz Orchestra played with the Leitieres, Leite, that it is a great conductor from Brazil that has this orchestra called Rumpilés, that plays rhythms inspiring from the Candomblé, the Afro diaspora rhythms, and they have this song called Professor Luminoso. There is one song composed by Leitieres Leite in the play Ijexá. Check it out, what they do in this song, in my opinion, is so interesting. So they play regular Ijexá. Is the same, just because you kind of changed a little bit the agogo rhythm part, the swing of the music, the feel of the music is completely different. You come from to something so syncopated like that. When you put the left, incredible fusions of the Ijexá in the modern way the people are playing. And I'm gonna show you guys the orchestra playing right now, because you guys need to check it out how that works with a full orchestra, you know, because it's just amazing.
Everton, could you possibly turn up the volume in the YouTube player?
Okay.
Thank you.
Loud enough?
what I say to you guys in the choir is going to change. Right now, what I say. What happened? Oh, so nice. There's a modern way, and I think one of my favorite way that they are using the Ijexá right now, when they blend with these, blend different rhythm patterns, and just create those beautiful music. So I think that's what I feel. And I think as an evolution of the Ijexá and how it was inserted in the Brazilian music, you know? So if you guys have any questions, you guys wanna ask anything, I'm here to be happy to answer.
Oh, you can't see me.
Right now, I can see you.
It's Andrea. The question I have, Everton, is the Ijexá, is it considered a clave rhythm, or it's not considered a clave rhythm because where it comes from is a different region?
No, it is considered a clave rhythm. It is considered a clave rhythm. The thing it is, because the way that was it is inside of the popular Brazilian music, sometimes you don't hear the clave, you know, but the rhythm it is there. But like if you go during the ceremonies, it's always the same clave. Even the bateria, there is a modern way that people are playing right now. Let me see if I can show you. There is the samba reggae, they put the three surdos. You don't hear the you're not going to listen to the clave, but it works this way. Let me show you guys. And I think it's fascinating as well. I don't have the three surdos because of big drums. And I have my SP, the other sample sounds. I just don't know if you guys can see it. So. So the way they are playing right now in Brazil is like that. The sound is not good. Let me see if I can like make this sound better. Can you see the clave is different, but it's over there. The clave now they are playing. But you can see. That's what I think is fascinating about the Ijexá, because the clave you can play in so many ways, you know? It's not there, but it's there at the same time. But there is a clave. Another question?
Hi. So following on that, so the clave is there, and then the rhythms that accompany it, but it's the same clave always all the time? Is it the same pattern?
Yeah. Are you talking about inside the Brazilian popular music or the religion?
The religion.
In the religion, the same thing all the time. Oh. Even if the guy... And even if the guy that plays the, let's see, the delay, he does something different, could be okay. The room, you is a kind of improvisation, but it's a conversation. But the guy that plays the agogô bell, he improvises, forget about it. That's like a big mistake inside the religion. It's the only guy that cannot not add or take it out one note. Need to be ken ken kon 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 ken ken kon kon ken ken kon kon. All the time. No more.
So it resembles the pattern of the bells.
Yeah.
The bells are the most important thing.
Over there in the religion, always first voice, the singing, and after the call bell. Because the voice is gonna say the song that you're going to sing, like the kind of the rhythm pattern they're going to sing, you know. So always the singing first. And after the agogô bell, because over there called gun action.
Can you show us a little bit of the interaction between the singers and the performance of the bells and the singing on the religion part?
So you want me to sing something? I don't sing. Like putting me in a good spot. Let me see if I can do something.
Oh. I mean,
I want to sing a little bit of this song that is the most famous Ijexá song. Let me see if this step works. Let me adjust the camera.
So the pattern maintains the groove, and then the improvisation goes along with it.
Yeah, it goes along with it. And like I said, the agogô, I always keep the same thing. The gun, I always keep the same thing. And the guy that plays the room is having the conversation with the orisha, you know? He's always working this way. Another question? Let me come closer to you.
Hey, so does the samba, has the samba originated from this music?
Yes.
So, and bossa nova after that?
Yeah, some people say the samba came from this rhythm from Angola called samba. There is this rhythm called samba, but inside of the African religion, the candomblé, there is another rhythm called samba cabila, samba de caboclo, they like rhythms that comes from the religion. So, and I feel it's closer to those rhythms to the samba from Angola, you know? The name is so similar, samba e samba. So, some like people that study, they say they came from samba, and some people say they came from samba cabila. So there's a kind of
is that like, all in Brazil?
Sorry?
Is that Brazil? Is somebody, you're saying the names of the places, I don't know where they're from.
Yeah, just like Africa, you know, these rhythms that came from Africa, places in Africa, like Simba is from Angola in Africa.
Angola, oh, I got it, I hear, okay.
Yes. So let me put it. Some Angola in Africa, and Samba Kabila is a rhythm that came from the Yoruba, like region, that is the Nigeria, around Nigeria, Benin, and
Western Africa.
Western Africa. So it is inside of the candomblé as well. So that's the thing that people are conflicted about. You know, if you like came from Simba or Samba Kabila. But if you think like, if you just play like musically, if you think musically, I think it's closer of the Samba Kabila than the Simba.
Okay.
Name is closer to the Simba, but I think the rhythm is closer of the Samba Kabila. The Kabila from Jesuit religion.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Welcome. No.
I was just wondering, I know it's not related to scat singing, no, rhythm. Just rhythm, but when Brazilian scat sing, they sing like naya, 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 naya. I was just wondering how. What does it mean, like naya, 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 naya?
Especially in samba, we have a lot of that, and I think it's more like just to create a melody, make the music more fun, you know? I think it's not like on purpose, and like, of course, it doesn't mean anything, but if you see like that kind of groovy, especially when you play samba, la la ya la la ya la ya, is it that you sing? La la ya la la ya la ya. So in Brazil, we're gonna hear a lot of la la ya le 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 wo wo because it's groovy, you know, it's part of our music, but doesn't mean anything.
Like bebop.
Yeah.
Bebop.
Wow.
Okay.
Thank you. It's the onomatopoeic, rendition of the instruments.
Yeah.
Wow. Everton, thank you so much for sharing your knowledge about these rhythms. Do you think that Ijexá has a big influence on capoeira music?
For sure. I think, actually, in my opinion, the way that you play the capoeira people, in the capoeira rhythm, the who is played is Ijexá. And if you see, is one of the improvisations, one of the phrases on the improvisation, because I know some groups has like variations. So some groups play like that, like the Ijexá shot, and I heard group play. And the old way, if you hear, sometimes you're gonna hear the capoeira play. For sure, capoeira and Ijexá is together. Once, I heard one capoeira mestre saying that he doesn't like when the capoeirista play Ijexá roda because they say candomblé in capoeira is two things completely different. But me as a musician, it's not two things completely different because they came from the same place, you know? So you cannot separate. So capoeira in the Ijexá rhythm, I think, is over there. Even the pandeiro, tu, tum, pa, tum, tum, pa, tum, e tum, pa, tum, tum, pa, tum, 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 pa, tum. So, but like they, like kind of play the opposite, in Ijexá they play pa, pa, pum, pa, pa, pum, pa, pa, pum. And then capoeira go tum, tum pa tum, tum pa tum. So in my opinion, is for sure is related. came from the Ijexá, I believe they came from Ijexá, the capoeira rhythm para de explain the ago de atabaque. Jesus.
It's really interesting to hear that those two rhythms, you know, it's like one places the accent more on, like, I know we're not like talking so much about musical notation, but for lack of a better term, it places more of the accent on like the half note, and then like the reverse of that is kind of more of the accent on the fourth quarter note. And I feel like both of those rhythms cover a very broad region in Latin America, you know?
Yeah.
But I also just wanted to ask, if you don't mind, talking a bit about your, I don't know what that drum is called, but it really reminds me of a djembe, and like, not only like how it's made, but the sound that's coming out of it.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna my the drum. So, like I said in the beginning, there's the atabaque. It's a Brazilian instrument, of course, came from Africa, but it's present in the capoeira as well. Animal skin, usually gold. You see the head. This one is tuned with chords, you know, but you can see like the regular way, like the real, like congas and all the instrument, you know. It is like pieces of wood, and they put it together in the glue, and have this piece of iron to like put it, keep it together, you know. And this way, you can make music. This atabaque is so interesting because, where is my hammer? Because if you need to tune, you need like a kind of hammer, because that's the way you tune. Can you see?
Oh, it tightens the strings.
Sorry?
It tightens the strings. You have a wedge, a piece of wood that wedges inside the rope.
Yeah.
I see.
When you
oh, no wrench.
Yeah, I don't know if you guys can see, let me put a little down.
Yeah.
So when you hammer, aí the tune goes higher, you know? But there is other ways. So that's the atabaque. So another thing that is so important, and I really wanna do one thing that I wanna say today, it is the Ijexá. When people start like playing outside of the candomblé, people start playing this rhythm, especially like the drum set players, they start playing like the bass drum. And this is the only rhythm pattern that you don't have inside of the bateria. Inside of the three atabaques, you never gonna hear the tum-dum, tum-dum, tum-dum. I don't know if the first guy that start playing this one heard this one. Interpreted like this way, but this rhythm doesn't exist inside, at least inside of the candomblé, inside of the Ijexá, the real one, the way they play. You cannot play, you're not even gonna listen to this rhythm part. It's always. No. This is wrong. And so many people play this way. So many people play this way.
Why?
I don't know, that's the thing. I don't know if like I say, if the first person that try to bring this rhythm to the drum kit, to the drum set, like interpreted the rhythm this way, like he heard, and like, oh, that's the way they play. And I can tell for sure, because that started a long time ago, and so many people copied their way to play.
They simplified it.
Yeah, they simplified it. But I think the guy that started playing there like understood kind of differently, you know? He stood a different way. And so many people start copying the same way, but you're never going to listen to this rhythm pattern when you're going to see the full bateria inside of the terreiros, in the candomblé part.
So play again the right way, the correct way, and then...
Wait, this one is the most closest of the wrong way, so...
The wrong way, okay.
That's the right way.
That's not good.
Yeah.
I hear the difference.
It's kind of push the rhythm back, you know?
Yeah. The right way is more forward.
Yeah, push.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, we got it. That's right.
Party, baby.
Yeah.
Yeah, all this music, we have to just stay home.
Yeah, the difference. Questions?
Nope.
If you guys have more questions, just bring, because Ijexá for me is one of the most fascinating rhythm, and I see Ijexá in so many things. Go ahead,
Everton, yeah. How long have you been playing?
Whoa. That's why I say to everybody, it's really hard to answer that. That's really hard to answer to me, because I feel music for me started my life early, but I didn't understand like music, because I grew up on the streets playing music, you know? Music in Brazil don't go to the like academy or anything to learn, so I was on the street. And I remember around like, I had like 11, 12 years old, 13 years old. I was like around my friend. I was playing the cars on the street, pen, those kind of things. Later on, I got a scholarship to study music. And I started, and after I went to university, and I became a professional musician. But I remember until I had like 18 years old, I wasn't thinking about music like as a career. When I finished school and I say, oh, I'm gonna do that, I'm gonna see what's gonna happen in my life, because I really love music, but you know, sometimes you're scared, you know, especially in Brazil, you know, how things are complicated, if you're gonna be able to survive just doing music. But I made it, was really good. The best decision that I had in my life, in because I follow my passion, you know.
How does the pattern of becoming a musician, is it easy, is it hard in Brazil?
It is so complicated, especially because to survive, I feel, at least in Salvador, the city that I came from, if you want to survive just making music, you need to play with some famous artists. I'm saying like a singer, like some famous band, to be able to make a living through music, especially when I was growing up doing music. Later, musicians start to be more independent, do their own music, and be able to survive. But right now, with the crisis, a lot of musicians are complaining. Even before the coronavirus thing was already hard, because they just not invest in the culture anymore, you know? And I'm lucky because I came through this social program called Neojibá, that is like one of the biggest projects in Brazil. And I learned everything there. I spent like more than 10 years over there, and I studied music, and I taught music as well. And it was an orchestra that used to play and teach the little kids at the same time. Copy of the El Sistema from Venezuela. And that's what one of my schools. So if you're not one of these part of one of these projects in Brazil, it's really hard to to survive? Or you play with some artists? Or you like teaching? Because if you just like, I want to play, I want to survive just playing drums and making sure just playing drums by myself, I think it's going to be so complicated to do that in Brazil, you know?
I have a question, Everton. So Ijexá is connected with the Candomblé religion, right? Which has a lot of parallels with like Santeria in Cuba and Ra-Ra in Haiti. And I'm wondering if, like in Cuba, different orishas have their own rhythms and have their own, like have a whole variety of patterns that people play. And is there a similar type of different types of rhythms in Ijexá, or is it mostly based on the songs? Or like, I'm curious about that. I'm curious about how the religion and the different orishas factor into the music.
Yeah, because there is even one of the nations, because in the Candomblé we have the nations. You say the Yoruba, the Angola, the Jeji, and there is, one of these are the Ijexá. They say that there is one, this nation called Ijexá. And the orishas, the name is so similar of the ones in Cuba, like Oxum, Ogun, Omolu, the names are almost the same. You see, like, they have three instruments. We have three instruments as well. And so I think came from the same place in with the African diaspora, because the slavery to different places. And the way that they figure it out to make the religion alive. So they kind of figure it out different way to celebrate. But I think came from the same place, you know. Even when they speak Yoruba, when I hear like Oro Cantado from Cuba, it's the same thing when I heard the Yoruba in Brazil, you know. You can see the words are so close. So I think it's completely connected, you know.
Are the similarities between the Yoruba in Cuba and in Venezuela and in Brazil and in Guyana? I mean, they all came together, but the ones in northern Brazil are different than the ones in southern Brazil, no?
Mm-hmm.
Or are they the same? Are they the same thing?
Because in Brazil there is other religions called, for example, like Umbanda is like the mix of Candomblé and the Catholic religion. So you have these fusions as well. So things that came more like from the southeast of Brazil, you know, and they mix with Candomblé, and they don't, because the one that came 100% for Africa, they just sing in Yoruba. The songs are in Yoruba. And when you go to the Umbanda, you're going to hear Portuguese as well. So it's a kind of more, you know, the religion.
And it's mostly on the south, right?
Yeah, you can see Salvador as well, the northeast, but that's like the center or south of to Brazil. I think you're gonna, I'm not sure about that, but I think the Umbanda religion is more like common in this area of Brazil, you know?
And in your area, in Salvador, I mean, what is the most predominant religion there?
You're talking about from the Candomblé?
From the Candomblé point.
Because I think it's the Jeje. I think you have Jeje Angola. I think it's Keto. I think Keto is the one that you're going to see more. But you have Angola, you have Jeje. I think Keto is the one that you have more. We say terreiros.
And then each one has its own singing, right?
Yeah. They have the way to celebrate it is the same. They were like the shape, we say the structure of the party, the orisha that you need to play first, second, you know? But the names are different, the way they do the parties, when they do the parties are different, they have a calendar, everything, you know, so depends. But it's one religion that came from Africa, and you say that we distribute to nations, you know?
Quick question for you.
Go ahead, Dimitris.
That's me. Hey.
Hi.
So, like, who are the people that you love to listen to the most? Like, who are your mentors and who are the people that when you listen to them play, you're like, wow, that guy is amazing. That woman is amazing. Like, who do you really like to listen to?
Whoa, I can tell you so many. Let's see. Gilberto Gil, for sure, was one of the artists from Brazil that inspired me the most. He plays guitar, he sings, but the way that he plays guitar, the way that he sings, like, so percussive. It's like groovy 100%. I love Gilberto Gil. I love Naná Vasconcelos. He's one percussionist from Brazil. Naná Vasconcelos. There's another one called Carlinhos Brown that is from my city. And I really think he's one of the most, like, incredible musicians. Let me see more musicians. I really like Salif Keita, like Fela Kuti. I really like musician from Yusson Odun. I spent one time in my life that I was listening to Yusson Odun. I don't know if you know this guy. He's from Senegal. I listen to him a lot. I cannot, like, say how long. Yusson Odun is one of my favorites.
Wait, how do you spell that guy's name?
It's really hard to spell. Like you in English, S-S-O-O-D-O-R. I think it's like, I can check it out and put in the...
Yeah, it's stuff indoor.
You know what we've been doing, everything? We've actually been coming up with, like, a list of the artists that people reference in their classes. So you and I can talk after this and come up with, like, a list that I can share with everyone who's on the class, who's participating, and we can send them a list or a playlist or whatever so they can check out all the stuff you're talking about.
Yeah, that sounds great. But I think I was influenced by so many musicians. And another thing is funny because in Brazil, when I went to university, I couldn't study, like, Brazilian music, so I studied classical percussion. And I think that's part of my life is I really love classical percussion. So I studied these, like, Tchaikovsky guys, Tchaikovsky, Beethoven, Stravinsky, and then I love the music as well, you know? And, yeah, I think music, I got music from everywhere, and I think the way that I do music right now, for sure, is influenced by all these people.
How has the classical helped your folkloric playing, if it has helped at all?
Yeah, it helped a lot, especially because in Brazil, some musicians say this thing when you learn, like, just play classical percussion, you lose your swing, you know? Some musicians, they're, but that's completely wrong. And so the way they helped me was because I grew up playing on the street, and I just couldn't understand the things that I learned before on the paper, because sometimes you just learn how to read and write music to actually later learn the rhythms. But I kind of did the opposite, so that helped me a lot. And now when I want to, like, especially those kind of things that I play that needs a lot of coordination, and I put in a write down and I can see when the hand fits with another. And for me, it makes it way easy to understand and make these, like, crazy things with so many rhythm patterns, like polyrhythm things, like using my feet, my hands, and everything. So, and especially the melody, you know? I think congas, for me, I feel like a bass sometimes. And atabaque, the same way. So, I think the classical music helped me a lot. When I listen to timpanis playing, and I see these three surdos in samba reggae, the surdos from samba reggae. The same thing. I really like it. So for sure, music is only one thing. And I never separate classical from the folkloric popular Brazilian music. For me, music is only music, you know?
Everton, I love your passion.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Oh, it's great.
Oh, I appreciate it.
Thank you. And your knowledge, but your passion is so wonderful.
Yeah, I think there's one thing special about, one thing about music, and I think I moved here because of that, you know, my passion. Because in music, I had some moments, you know, you think what you're gonna do, you're gonna do, but I think your passion drives you to the right place.
Sure.
And I feel so blessed I'm here in New York today with you guys, especially being able to share my knowledge, because I really appreciate all my teachers, you know. That's what I, even over here, and after like 15 years of university, and I always try to say how helpful was all information they gave to me. Even my friends, I was talking, I gave like, we did like a live session, the Instagram, and one of the questions that I had was, what was the people that inspired the most when you grew up in playing music? And I say it was all my friends, because I'm practicing with another friend and I said, oh man, you play this thing, it's different. Can you show me? So you learn only one thing from your friend sometime, but like this thing change you like your whole life, but you know, so I have 1,000 masters in my life. Who is your master? I had so many masters. All my friends had like direct influence in my music, you know? So all my friends.
Thank you for being here. Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope to meet you in person one day.
Yeah, make music. Let's
play. Yes, yes. Monday nights.
Monday
nights, yeah. Monday nights in Brooklyn.
Let's do it.
Everton, I had a question. It really interested me how you were saying that there's like, for you, you know, like classical and folkloric music are kind of all in the same. And like, you know, a lot of composers like Tchaikovsky, they're like really interested in Russian folk music, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering if you've had experience with like, you know, folk music in places other than Latin America, or if not, could you just like talk more about maybe some elements that you find really relatable between like your classical and folkloric experience musically?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a trick question. So in Brazil, we have this music style called forró. I don't know if you heard it, and I think so clear, the fusion of the European music in the Brazilian music, especially because you have the accordion. And the other day, I was listening to a Greek song, and they have an instrument that is exactly like the zabumba that we have in Brazil. So you see the things that came from Europe, it is in Brazil as well. And even the way they communicate, because I read they used back in the day, they used to, the timpanis used to be like the way that the soldiers was marching. They used the timpanis like to put the downbeat and everybody do it together. So I think in music works a lot like that, you know? The drum is always over there, especially in the samba. Você tá tuk tiku tuk tiku tuk tiku tuk tiku tuk tiku pum tiku tuk. When you the dance, like the downbeat goes with you. So I think this thing about music and European, Brazilian, I think it's all blended, you know? And for sure, all of that influenced my music.
Thank you.
I don't know if I answered your question, but...
No, I just wanted to hear you talk more about it. It was really interesting.
Yeah. It's something like that. It's something like that, for sure.
So, Afoshe is the most, is the one that you will consider the most influenced by both European and Brazilian?
Yeah, Afoshe, I think, is one I consider one of the most present inside the popular Brazilian music. And the thing it is, because maracatu, if you come, if you play, people are gonna feel, oh, you play maracatu, if you play this clave. So if you play, you know, so makes it easier to notice. But like with the Ijexá, because like I said, the Sandra de Sá playing this, the olhos coloridos, the groove is in the guitar. It's the same thing. Kingin kong kong kong, kingin kong kong, kipting tick, mes olhos coloridos. So I think that's the interesting about the Ijexá. And people, a lot of people don't know because the Ijexá is kind of like, you know, the shy people, there's always like, in the corner, they wanna like talk too much. It's kind of the Ijexá it is sometimes in music because it's so funky. It's sometimes you when you play the even the American funk, the groove and you can like kind of sounds like the Ijexá. So I think Ijexá is so important, in especially in popular Brazilian music, you know?
I didn't know that.
Everton.
Go ahead.
One other thing that I thought was really cool was how much Brazilian musicians dig American funk music. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know very much about that until I started listening to like Tim Maia and like his like nephew. It's amazing. And then like all of the Brazilian disco and everything that came through that era, but it's amazing how there is that connection between like American funk music. And this is kind of the stuff I almost sometimes feel like it was an amazing wave of music that was appreciated throughout the US, whether it was like the Bee Gees or, you know, Parliament Funk. There are just artists that were making just really, really good music. Well, for me, good music, because I'm old, whatever. Nah. But at the same time, I didn't appreciate how much that funk flavor from like the late 60s, 70s into the 80s, like early 80s even, was also felt in Brazil. Did you grow up with any favorite funk artists? Everything from Stevie Wonder, of course, he had his funk period. So what about you? Did you grow up with any favorite funk tunes?
When I was, it's not like funky, funky, but when I was good, I have like, one of the guys that I listened a lot was Michael Jackson, was little for sure. And I think Michael Jackson is funky. But one of the bands that influenced me a lot was even talking about that with my friend Jesus that is over here right now. I went to visit him 2 years ago. And was the Anaíma. was the Tower of Power. Do you know this group? I listened to Tower of Power a lot. Tower of Power, I had like so many CDs and I was listening to Tower of Power a lot. I couldn't, the way that David Garibaldi, because he went to Cuba, he went to Brazil as well. So the way that he was playing drum set wasn't like the regular. You could see like song, you could see samba, you could tell that he was like full of groovy, like from all over the world, man. So Tower of Power, it was one of the bands I heard so many, listen a lot. I listen a lot to Tower of Power, Stevie Wonder for sure. Yeah. Bee Gees, I like it. I like jazz a lot as well. I heard so many jazz, especially Miles Day, Coltrane, love those. Listen to Elvin Jones playing drum set, just magical. Like Tony Williams. You know, all those guys is just like amazing. Billy Cobham, he went to Brazil once and I saw him playing, it was amazing. So all those American, I think Brazil is influenced by American culture a lot. It's not just in music, in just so many things, you know, in so many things. And I think that's great. That's I really feel this piece of me here after, because I have only almost 4 years, I have 3 years and a half, I think 3 years living in New York. And I think the thing that I connected when I moved was this part, you know, because I heard the music a lot and I was influenced in a lot of sense. So I think that was the piece kind of like was waiting for me over here. And I felt that when I moved to New York, you know, that's so cool.
You've got it. You got to get into P-Funk.
Yeah.
George Clinton is retiring. If you can catch one of his shows before he retires, He's been retiring. You have to catch one of their shows.
Okay.
George Clinton and P-Funk All-Stars. It's like no other.
Okay. I'll check it out. For sure.
Miles Davis was actually loved Sly and the Family Stone, too.
Yeah.
He was a huge fan of Sly and the Family Stone. So also check out Sly and the Family Stone.
Is fabulous, yeah.
I'll check it out, these guys. So thank you for letting me know. Well, let me close this. Now you guys can see my face. Man. If you guys have more questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Everton, is there a fixed number of instruments in the candomblé bateria?
There is. So always you're gonna see the rumpi, the led, there is the three atabaques. The three atabaques, like this one, like different sizes. The gun, there is this one. So like four. And sometimes they have shakere. Shakere. And sometimes Andrea with the shaker. You see cachixi as well. There's another beautiful instrument in Ijexá. At the beginning, they used to play just the downbeat. And now you can play it. So there's another Brazilian instrument that is so cool. In Espanhol, but in the candomblé, the one that you're gonna see, it is the gan, rum, rumpi, and lé. That's the one that always you need to make the music inside of the celebrations. Now we're waiting. Let me see in the chat for you guys. Oh.
Well, I mean, if there's no other questions, then I think the best thing we can do is say thank you and give Everton a round of applause for an incredible class.
I wanna like say thank you so much, Zach, Afro Latin Jazz, Arturo Ferro, all of you guys to make that happen, because I'm so proud of being part of the teaching artist team of the Afro Latin Jazz and play with the orchestra as well. And now be able to still come over here and give it this class and talk about my culture. For me, that's like, it's beautiful, you know? So that means a lot for me. And I wanna thank all of you guys for coming. And I hope you guys got something for Ijexá. And if you guys wanna like just play, let's play, reach me out. I'm all over social media. We can have a conversation, keep talking, not just about Ijexá, but all kind of Brazilian music in the like the world. Like I say, let's talk about funky. Let's just learn, you know, and play music.
Yeah, man. Thank you, Everton. And I also just want to let everyone know that if you want to see some more of Everton playing, he played with the Afro Latin Jazz Orchestra's Virtual Birdland. Not this past Sunday, but the previous Sunday, they played a piece by Leitieres, Leite. That's in the orchestra's repertoire, so you can see him there. And he's also going to be featured with the orchestra on July 5th for their Virtual Birdland series, along with Paquito de Rivera. So you have opportunities to see Everton playing. In addition to, he's got all sorts of great stuff online too. So yeah, thank you, man. This is incredible. I also would like to just take a second and give my usual spiel. For anyone who wasn't here at the very beginning, I'm Zach O'Farrell. I'm the Director of Education Programs at ALJA. And I just want to take a second and let everyone know that, you know, if you like what we did today, we have master classes every Wednesday. You can always find out about them on our Facebook page, our Instagram page, at Afro Latin Jazz Alliance for both of them. Give us a like, follow us, stay in touch. And, you know, hopefully we'll see you again on another Wednesday. We have more concerts online coming up. And if anyone's not aware of it, we also, when all the COVID crisis started, we created the ALJA Emergency Artists Fund to help support artists who are struggling and lost all their work during this crisis. So if you have the means, we appreciate any and all donations. 100% of all funds donated to the ALJA Emergency Artist Fund go straight to musicians in need. We don't take any administrative fees or anything. But all the money goes straight to musicians and other artists, people who work in the music industry. We got a stand-up comedian who applied last week. Check out what we do, afrolatinjazz.org. Follow us on Facebook and Instagram, and follow Everton while you're at it also. As you can see, he's the man. And I just want to say thank you again to Everton for sharing your knowledge with us. And thank you to everyone who was here for participating.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Zach, this is going to be on YouTube, right?
This is on YouTube as we speak. This is still on YouTube.
we'll make sure that it gets posted.
Yeah. All right. Speaking of which, I'm gonna end the stream and we're gonna be off of YouTube now.